Okay, welcome. Geez, I am so excited to be here again. And I hope you're having a fantastic morning. We have something here with the chat. I have to say, this whole live stream thing with all these different switch checks. Robert is here again, helping us make it work. It seems to be very complicated, but we're just working on getting the chat up now. And Anne is here as well. And I have lots of questions, some of them from last month, which we never got to. A number of people were giving me suggestions on what kind of camera I should get. And I would say the vast majority is just use your iPhone, you dope. So I ended up getting a new iPhone, the 13, because in terms of shooting YouTube and photographs, it just seemed like a good idea, and shooting video. So I got that. So thank you for all your suggestions on that. And I thought that I'd head straight into showing you some slides and starting off before the first question, just showing you a few images of my wife Anne's paintings, because a number of people said after last week's video, oh, we wanted to see Anne's painting because we were out painting there by the Pacific Ocean together. But she, you know, she was painting a larger thing and it wasn't finished. So I'm just going to show you a few. Oh, yeah, yeah. Anne, come. Sorry. Come say hello.
Where do I look?
Here's my lovely. Well, no, you look here.
Oh,
that's
I look
the
there.
Camera. It's very distracting because you think you're over there, but you're actually here.
Well, just it's nice to see everybody out there in cyberspace, and three cheers for this guy who's working so hard. Okay, we're going to get the chat working.
Yeah, I'm sorry about the chat, because the whole thing about the chat is you can ask questions, but I don't know what is going on there. So I'm going to show you four of Anne's paintings, and I've always loved this one. When I talk about seeing in shapes, this is done live. She's looking at that. This is a plein air painting, and you can see she is seeing in shapes. I mean, that's just, there's no detail, right? Just enough to sort of pull your attention back to that little green hit at the back of the field. There's that last one was sort of 10 by 12. This is more like 20 by 24. Again, done from life. She just sets things up outside, sets up still lifes outside and paints them from life. But you see how simple she's making the flowers, like lit side, dark side. And there's one, again, done outdoors from life. And, you know, it didn't stay like that for very long. Obviously, the sun would have been shifting very quickly, but she caught those specific shapes and then moved on. This is a series of paintings she did not this summer, but last summer. This one, I think, is 30 by 40, maybe. But she just was out in the garden looking at a flower bed in our backyard and just painted that thing from life, big. And then she also does a lot of iPad drawings. And this is just one of them. And again, it's just very simple shapes. You know, there's not a lot of, I mean, you might be able to, she uses Procreate. You might be able to make more complicated gradations and color things, but she just uses it very simply in terms of those those simple shapes. So the first question that was asked, or the first question, actually the one left from last week, DFW. Can painting be about something that is not the focal point? And I wanted to show you a painting, quite a famous painting, really.
Do you mind pausing for 1 second? We could just see if we could get the chat up so that people could be...
Sure. But does it mean like going offline?
No, just pausing for 1 second if everybody doesn't mind. Because I know people would probably...
No, we should have the chat for sure. Yeah. I don't know why. I mean, last time it was just there automatically.
Yeah. So we're just going to give this 1 second because I know that that's such a nice component of all of this is for people to be able to put...
So I can talk about this painting in the meantime. So when you're saying that a painting is about something, this is a painting by Poussin, sort of late 1600s. And it's called Landscape with a Snake. And the snake is down in the bottom left. And would you say that's the most important part of the painting? In fact, this guy running from it and the woman sort of in the middle who's like scared, that's one narrative within the painting, right? But then there's a much bigger narrative. If you really wanted to just tell the story of a snake and two people, you wouldn't fill three quarters of the painting with landscape. The landscape is a huge narrative, this big circular form going way back in space at the same time. So there's a coexisting of a narrative, snake with people, and the other narrative, which is landscape itself. And then you could say, take a painting like this one by Caravaggio. Now, everything is focused to doubting Thomas, wanting to make absolutely sure this is Jesus. All the figures are pointing there. All the details are subordinated to that one motion. You can see the way they're looking, the way the hands are going. It all orchestrates to that one focal point. So there's a pictorial logic here that matches the narrative logic. You know, we're telling a story and we want to make sure that we're really focusing in on the most important thing. So here we have the same thing where, again, it's Caravaggio, the supper at Emos, and you see this motion from the top right along the heads, Christ head, down that the back of that figure on the left, the hand pushing up towards that figure on the right, which curves around his arm and shoulder. You see him looking straight at Christ. So the whole thing is a big circular motion right back to Christ. And the whole thing, both the pictorial logic and the narrative logic, are working towards that. Now, I wanted to show you something here on the iPad. This is a painting that I did last week, right? So here I had organized this, that this would be the center of interest. And I really diminished the house, which it was a really bright white house. I really diminished that in order to make sure that we were coming here. But if I make the buildings lighter, right, I can start to pull our attention this way. And interestingly, because of this triangle leading to the buildings, it's possible that you could plan that. And there's where you see. But look at what happens when you take a painting like this. Let me just adjust the color a little bit. So we've got a structure that is working towards taking us back to here. You can feel it when you look at the painting, right? The whole thing pulls us back to here. But if you take something and go like this, then you can feel your eye getting pulled up here, and it's like that becomes the center of interest, and it now has no pictorial logic. That makes sense from a pictorial logic standpoint. That does not. That does. So I think this idea of can you have more than one focal point is, in a way, no, because the whole thing needs to be orchestrated in one way. And to have no focal point is a little bit like having a plotless story. It's like, well, where are we going here? Why are we going there?
Before you go to the next one.
Yeah.
We're going to try and get the chat working. We just may need a pause.
Yeah.
Well, in a couple minutes.
Okay.
Okay.
And then there's the thing of figures in the landscape, which I tend not to put figures in my landscapes too much because, I mean, unless it's seriously engaged with the figure. But look here at, oops, not that one. That. Now, this is Edward Sego. And he died, I think, in the 50s or maybe the 60s, but he's a British painter. And you can see that horse and carriage on the road, how riveting that is to our attention. You could get rid of that And the painting would still probably work. You might have to do something back there. But the figure completely orchestrates how we're actually looking at it. And then if you look at this one, also by Edward Segal, you know, this is a watercolor, very, very simple, but the figures here completely dictate the narrative. We don't know what the narrative is exactly, but you can see how important that is. So here's another one. Look at this painting. This is a guy named Thomas Daly. Now, it's a very quiet landscape, right? Very sort of soft, muted day. And normally we would be sort of pulled back along that vertical back into the background. But that one tiny figure and the idea of a fisherman on the bank makes sense from a narrative standpoint. And there's this nice long curve from the lower left up to that figure that absolutely embeds him into the structure of the painting. He's not just stuck off on one side. Oh, good. Yes. They say they figured out why there is no...
We did, and I bet people are really wanting to chat. So if you...